Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. Today we will talk about bioavailability and bioequivalent studies and its estimation. Now, what is bioavailability? Bioavailability is the measurement of the rate and extent to which a therapeutically active chemical is absorbed from a drug product into the systemic circulation and become available at the site of action. For example, drugs that are taken orally, the active ingredients are released in the gastrointestinal tract and arrive at the site of action via systemic circulation. So, when we are taking parenteral drug, so the bioavailability will be maximum 100% because the drug is directly given in the blood. So, blood concentration of the active ingredients and or their active metabolites thereby provide a marker for the concentration at the site of action and a valid measure of bioavailability. A blood concentration time curve, that is AUC curve, reflects not just the release of the active ingredient from the drug and its absorption from the GI tract, but also other factors including pre-systemic metabolism, distribution and elimination. Now, what is bioequivalence? If two drugs are bioequivalent, there is no clinically significant difference in their bioavailability. So, mostly in case of generic one, that the bioavailability should be same with the branded one. Although bioequivalence is most commonly discussed in relation to generic drugs, it is important to note that bioequivalence studies are also performed for brand name drugs in some situations, like between early and late clinical trial formulations or between the formulations used in clinical trials and the product to be marketed for new drugs. When changes in formulation have occurred after a brand name drug has been approved, for example, change in one or more excipient in active ingredient, bioequivalence studies are a surrogate marker for clinical effectiveness and safety data, as it would not normally be necessary to repeat clinical studies for generic products. For oral drugs, it is accepted that if blood concentration of the active ingredient of the generic and branded drugs are the same, then their concentration at the site of action and therefore their safety and effectiveness will also be same. So in case of generic one and the branded one, the bioavailability, if the bioavailability is same, we are assuming that it is bioequivalent, that the generic one is having all the potential that is with the branded one. For other dosage form, for example, drugs for inhalation, topical or parenteral use, bioequivalence can be demonstrated through other comparative testing, for example, comparative pharmacodynamic studies, pharmaceutical properties, in addition to or in lieu of comparative bioavailability to support the safety and efficacy of the proposed product. For oral drugs, bioequivalence is determined by comparing the relative bioavailability of the brand name drug versus the generic drug. There must be no more than 20% difference between the AUC and Cmax of the brand name versus generic products. This is based on international consequences that difference below the percentage rate are not clinically significant. In order to establish bioequivalence, the AUC and Cmax for the generic drugs are compared with that of the branded drug. Now, bioequivalence is based on comparison of ratios, where the ratio of generic to branded name for each pharmacokinetic variable does not differ by more than 8:10. This is how The range for the confidence interval is defined, that is 8 by 10 equals to 0.8 gives the lower limit, and 10 upon 8 1.25 gives the upper limit. So it is basically the ratio, that the ratio should be between 0.8 to 1.25, the ratio of the Cmax and the 90% confidential interval for the ratio of AUC, and should be contained within the limits of 0.8 to 1.25. Now we will talk about the estimation, that how we are going to estimate there are two methods, pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics. In case of pharmacokinetics, we can use plasma level time studies and urinary excretion studies. In pharmacodynamics, acute pharmacological response and therapeutic response. Now, we will talk about pharmacokinetics. Basically, it is based on assumption that the pharmacokinetic profile reflects the therapeutic effectiveness of drug. These are basically indirect methods. And in case of pharmacokinetics, it involves direct measurement of drug effects on the physiological process, such as function of time. And it is a direct measure. So pharmacodynamic is a direct measure, whereas pharmacokinetic is indirect method. Now we will discuss one by one. Okay. Now plasma level time study, single dose study. This method is based on the assumption of two dosage forms that exhibit superimposable plasma level time profiles in a group of subjects should result in identical therapeutic activity. With single dose study, the method requires collection of serial blood samples for a period of 2 or 3 biological half-lives after the drug is administered. Their analysis for drug concentration and making a plot of concentration versus corresponding time of sample collection to obtain the plasma level time profile. With IV dose, sampling should start within 5 minutes of drug administration and subsequently samples taken for 15 minutes interval. Because in case of IV drug, we are giving the drug directly in the blood. Now we will discuss about these terms. What is AUC, Cmax and Tmax? The AUC is proportional to the total amount of drug reaching the systemic circulation and thus characterize the extent of absorption. Cmax gives indication whether drug is sufficiently absorbed systematically to provide a therapeutic response. It is a function of both the rate and extent of absorption. Cmax will increase with an increase in the dose as well as with an increase in the absorption rate. Tmax. The Tmax reflects the rate of drug absorption and decreases as the absorption rate increases. This is the formula by which we can determine the bioavailability. F equals to AUC oral D IV, and D is known as drug dose. The dose of the drug administered. And AUC is area under curve. Now, the next method is urinary drug excretion. These studies are based on the premises that urinary excretion of the unchanged drug is directly proportional to the plasma concentration of total drug. As a thumb rule, determination of bioavailability using urinary excretion should be conducted only if at least 20% of the administered drug is excreted unchanged in the urine. So basically, what type of method you are using, it depends on the type of drug which is administered. The study is particularly useful for drug that extensively excreted unchanged in the urine, or drugs that have urine as the site of action. This method involves first collection of urine at regular intervals for a time span equals to 7 biological half-lives. In case of plasma, we were taking the blood samples up to 3 biological half-lives. But in case of urine samples, we are taking the sample up to 7 biological half-lives. Analysis of unchanged drug in the collected sample. Determination of the amount of drug excreted in each interval and cumulative excreted for obtaining valid result following criteria must be followed. At each sample collection, total emptying of the bladder is necessary to avoid errors. Frequent sampling of urine is also essential in the beginning. The fraction excreted unchanged in the urine must remain constant. Now, these three are the parameters which are used in case of urinary excretion. First, DXU upon DT max, it gives the rate of appearance of drug in the urine is proportional to its concentration in systemic circulation. Its value increases as the rate or extent of absorption increases. TU max, it is analogous to the plasma level data. Its value decreases as the absorption rate increases. XU, it is related to AUC of the plasma level data and increases as the extent of absorption increases. This is the formula to determine the bioavailability in case of drug excretion method. Now, acute pharmacological response used. This method is used when pharmacokinetic methods are difficult and inaccurate and non-reproducible, and acute pharmacological effects such as, for example, change in ECG, EEG readings, pupil diameter. So, in the pharmacokinetics, we are taking the samples like blood, urine, and in case of pharmacological responses, we are considering the responses that it changes in the diameter, change in the ECG readings. And now the disadvantages of acute pharmacological responses is more variable and accurate correlation between measured responses and available from the formulation is difficult. Active metabolite interferes with the result. Therapeutic response. Measurement of clinical response to the drug formulation given to the patient suffering from a disease for which it is intended to be used. So basically, what is happening, like if a patient, like we can take the sample, like we can take the blood or we can take the urine sample. So we are going for these another methods, that is therapeutic responses. Okay. And all these methods have some several disadvantages. So the disadvantages of therapeutic responses: improper quantification of observed response. Bioequivalence studies are usually conducted using a crossover design. Hope you understood about today's presentation, what is bioavailability and bioequivalence and methods of estimation. Thank you.